My name is Paul Finkelstein. I'm Artistic Planning Manager at the Saint Paul Chamber Orchestra, and we are so incredibly excited to be here tonight for a really special event in our ongoing festival called Tapestry 19. Each one of you probably has a little booklet containing essays written by many of the artists who've been involved in this festival, but I just thought I'd give you just a little rundown on what this whole Tapestry Festival is about. The idea was that we wanted, as an orchestra, but as an arts organization in the Twin Cities, to engage a group of artists, not just in the orchestra, but also around our community, around a theme that we could all speak to and discuss and get to know one each other through our art. So the theme that we're looking into this year is home, how we recognize home, which is an incredibly intimate topic. For some it can be abstract, for some it's a place, for some it's just an emotion, for others it's something completely different, something unattainable. And so tonight, we thought it would be great to get together with our partners and friends at the Eastside Freedom Library to present a group of unbelievable artists from around the Twin Cities responding to this theme. So the other thing that I just wanted to tell you about is that this is the fifth event that we've had in this festival. It concludes this coming weekend with concerts at the Ordway, and you'll see some information about that on the back cover of that booklet. The reason why we kind of hooked up with the Eastside Freedom Library was for a work that we commissioned from our composer in residence, Lemon Beecher, who's actually here in the aqua sweater, so you can grill him about this all later. We put together this piece for the orchestra that Lembit wrote that incorporates interviews that we conducted with 47 residents of the Twin Cities from all over the Twin Cities. And one of the partners we worked with to collect those interviews was the Eastside Freedom Library. So about 12 to 14 of those interviews were conducted downstairs in the kitchen, in the big room downstairs, with some of the people actually in the audience here tonight. And basically what we did in those interviews was we had them read a poem by Chris Santiago, who's a fantastic local poet who teaches at the University of St. Thomas, as well as respond to a series of questions about what home means to them. And then Lembit took what ended up being 27 hours of audio material that was collected. From that 27 hours of material, he culled out hundreds of audio clips that are then woven in and incorporated with the acoustic orchestral sound. So it's a really unique piece. I'm not fully aware of any other works that are quite like this that have been written. So I think it's going to be a really amazing experience this coming weekend. So I hope some of you can make it February 22nd to the 24th at the Ordway. And we also have a very special discount code for those of you who are here tonight. If you use the code ESFL30, you'll get 30% off on those tickets on the SPCO website. So you can visit thespco.org/tapestry to learn more about that. I'm going to turn it over to my friend Clarence, who will talk a little bit more about tonight.
So thank you for joining us tonight at the Eastside Freedom Library. I have a lot to say in just a few seconds because we want to leave time for all of our presentations and performers. The theme is home. The longest story and history of home of this place in this area is that of the Dakota people. And that runs through this entire history that is now shared by a lot of other people who have lived in this space over a very long time. We're glad to have a lot of different artists here this evening who will give us some interpretation of a story of home. I'm going to try and get everyone here because it's a long list of amazing performers. But in order of appearance, we have John Matsunaga, We have Kyu-Young Kim with Ariella Kim. We have Yodit Mekuria. We have Strong Buffalo, who will be joined by Ben Weaver, Jacqueline Ultan, and Mikkel. Jacqueline Ultan will give a special video presentation. Author Kao Kalia Yang, Saint Paul Kim, and we will finish with Mankwe Ndosi. So, again, thank you for coming out. Oh, one other thing. Today is Japanese American Day of Remembrance. We will be marking that with an event this Saturday at 7 o'clock, so we would love it if you joined us for that as well. There are a lot of other events that happen here all the time. We have something happening every night this week. There are flyers on the table there. There's some things that are happening not at night as well, if you're able to join us for that. We hope you've signed our guest book. If you haven't, before you leave, we would love it if you did. That way we can let you know about more that's happening here, and so you can join more conversations. At any point, there are restrooms downstairs. There's an elevator there and the stairs that way.
Food.
Oh, yes. There is some amazing food afterwards that we hope you'll share with us in the back there. So please do that. I think that is it. And with that, I am going to pass one of the mics off to John.
Visual artist and photographer, and I'm also a third-generation Japanese-American. In reflecting on this notion of home, I want to talk about two projects of mine that deal with the Japanese-American incarceration during World War II. And so today marks the 77th anniversary of the signing of Executive Order 9066 by President Franklin Roosevelt on February 19th, 1942. For those of you who may not know about or be very familiar with this history, Executive Order 9066 authorized the forced removal, exclusion, and mass incarceration of Japanese Americans living on the west coast of the United States. A total of 120,000 Japanese Americans were incarcerated in 10 American concentration camps from 1942 to 1946. This was done in direct violation of their constitutional rights, as they were never tried nor convicted of any crime. They were all incarcerated only because of their Japanese ancestry. And so my parents, my grandparents, and my aunts and uncles were all among those incarcerated. So these projects I will discuss touch upon issues of displacement and loss of home as they relate to the Japanese American incarceration. So the first project that I want to discuss is titled Nodoto Naiyoni, which is Japanese for Let It Not Happen Again. For this project, I traveled to all 10 of the camps where Japanese Americans were incarcerated during World War II and photographed the remains there. And so on this map, those camps are designated by these blue triangles here. So there are two in California, two in Arizona, two in Arkansas, and one each in Idaho, Wyoming, Utah, and Colorado. So my intention in this work is to convey a sense of uncertainty, ambiguity, and loss. While these photographs show you what remains, this work is really about absence and what is missing, forgotten, or unknown about this past. In these photographs, I try to emphasize this ambiguity as a way of thinking about displacement and the notion that while these camps are where Japanese Americans were imprisoned and housed, they were never home to them. So these footings here, these are footings for the barracks, which housed Japanese Americans. And these footings here are the footings for the barracks that my father and his family lived in the camp in Gila River, Arizona. So again, here, I'm using these kinds of traces, and it might be a little hard to tell, but these are footprints in a cement foundation. To convey a sense of absence, displacement, and loss, it's sort of a loss of history, a loss of memory, and a loss of identity that comes with being displaced and being forced from your home and removed from your communities. This project, for me, was also an act of pilgrimage and memory making, making my own memories of this past, connecting myself to this past that is meaningful to me, that I feel very deeply connected to, but that I did not experience. I was not incarcerated. And so it was a way of me of becoming closer to this past by going to these camps, bearing witness to what had happened, and connecting physically and bodily to these camps by actually being there. And I mean that in the sense that a lot of the things that people remember about the camps, those that were incarcerated, talk about the conditions, the extreme conditions of weather, or the dust storms, or you know, the gravel, and what it was like. It's very, you know, all this dirt everywhere, and these kinds of things. And so being there allowed me to kind of connect in that bodily way of experiencing what some of the conditions were like in some of these places. As a third generation Japanese American, I feel a responsibility to engage with this history and to bring attention to it so it's not forgotten. And importantly, that it never happens again to another community. And so I want to take a few moments here to quickly show you some photographs from this project, focusing on domestic remains, since we're talking about home a little bit, and we're contemplating that concept. And so, you know, these kinds of domestic remains are suggestive of home in an environment that was anything but that. And so here you can see a child's marble, you know, a little toy for a kid. This is a the leather covering for a baseball. And baseball was very popular within camp and engaged in by a lot of young people. Here are some assorted pieces of broken bottles, cups, bowls, and other personal items. All these kinds of things that people would have used in their daily lives in camp. And just all these little fragments. Here's a dish that can kind of serve as a metaphor for the fragmented families and communities whose members were often separated from one another. So they're being removed from their communities and separated from their friends and their neighbors. And then you even had family separation, members of families being separated as a part of this incarceration process. Now, another project of mine titled Kazoku no Tami ni, which means for the family or for the sake of the family, I've explored my family's connection to the Japanese-American incarceration through the use of family photographs and objects and old papers and things like that, and all, as well as contemporary portrait photographs that I made of my family members. And so I have been working on this in kind of collecting these images to make a photo book. And there's a version of it right over here. This is later. So it's kind of in progress, and there's a version of that if you want to take a look at it at some point. And so very few photographs exist of my family members from these years that they were incarcerated. And these are the few here that I have in my possession. There's uncles here, and then this is my mom here. It's from an actual school yearbook, so they have these yearbooks in camp as well, and that's, you know, those are like the, that's like the only image I have of her from that age as a little child. Because of this lack of photographs for my family during the incarceration, I wanted to make photographs for a past my family experienced, but for which few photographs existed. And I also wanted to explore the intergenerational connections to this incarceration history in my family. And so one way that I approached this was to photograph my parents and uncles in a kind of mugshot style, similar to which was used to document Japanese Americans for IDs and other official purposes within camp. While they were young, while my parents and my uncles were young at the time, while they were incarcerated, I wanted these photographs to kind of reference my grandparents, but then also the older first generation immigrant Japanese Americans. There were many Japanese Americans who were, you know, old that were in camp as well. And those were the first Japanese immigrants to the United States. And I don't have any photographs of my grandparents while incarcerated, so this is kind of a way of me visualizing that and creating a kind of visual record of that, of referencing of that. I also took my parents to Manzanar, which was one of the camps in California. And so neither of my parents were incarcerated at this particular camp. They were incarcerated at other camps. But they're in their 80s, and it was not really possible to take them to the camps that they were in to photograph them. But I wanted to place them within a camp kind of setting to photograph them as a way of visualizing them within this kind of camp environment, and sort of directly connecting them to this past. And so when I took them to Manzanar, they live in Los Angeles, so Manzanar is the closest camp, a few hours drive. And this was the first time that either of them had been back to any of the camps since their incarceration over 70 years ago. So on the right there is a self-portrait I took where I'm standing in the very location where my mother's barracks were in Jerome, Arkansas. And I was trying to create a kind of intergenerational connection, as I had mentioned before, to this incarceration past by placing myself where she once lived there. I also photographed my siblings and my niece and nephews. In exploring these kinds of intergenerational connections, I asked them to pick something that is important to them, but would have been taken away from them or something they couldn't take with them to camp if they were incarcerated today. And so my sister here on the right, I asked her, you know, that very question, what was something that you couldn't imagine, you know, that you have to give up and it would be very hard for you to do? And she had said that, you know, she found it very difficult, the idea of having to leave her home. You know, being taken from her home and just not being able to do anything about that. And so I photographed her in front of her house. And so my niece Candace on your left picked her dog Lily, because pets weren't allowed. You couldn't take your pets with you, you had to leave them behind. And my nephew Brandon picked his drone. So as a, you know, a drone is this kind of surveillance thing, cameras weren't allowed, these kinds of things would have been viewed, and today it would be viewed suspiciously, so that it would be something that would not be allowed to be taken. I also wanted these photographs to reference and stand in for my parents, who were young when they were incarcerated. So my dad was, when I took this photograph, Brandon, my nephew Brandon, was my dad's age when he went to camp. And so because I don't really have any images of my parents from this period, these images kind of stand in for and make me imagine or think about you know, who they were and what they looked like at that time. So by making these images, I'm trying to create a kind of archive of incarceration imagery that doesn't exist for my family, but it allows me in various ways to kind of connect with this past, either through other family members or myself being at these camps. And that's all I have to say about it.
Thanks, John. I just wanted to mention, I think it's the moon. Alicia McQuerrey is the other artist who will be sharing with us. I have a big list, so excuse me for that. But Kyu?
Everybody, it's great to be here. My name is Kyu-Young Kim, and this is my daughter Ariella. And I think if I were to capture what means to the most to me in terms of home, it's certainly family. And so I think of children laughing. I think of family game night, which is something that Ariella wrote down the other day, and our musical jam sessions. And so all those things bring us great joy. This is quite a contrast to what you shared with us, John. So, but that's sort of what I love about, with our Tapestry Festival, you have these extreme swings in mood, but they're all on the same idea of what is home. So this is a very fun piece. It's by a man named Alan Redoubt. I don't know anything about him, but he wrote this great piece called Ferdinand and Bull, and it's with words by Monroe Leaf. Monroe Leaf. So it's a book that maybe some of you have heard, and it's wonderful music. And this is Ariella's debut as narrator.
Play with other the little balls and skip and butt your heads, she would say. Understanding, even though she was a cow, she let him sit there and be happy. As the years went by, Ferdinand grew and grew until he was very big and strong. All the other bulls who had grown up with him in the same pasture would fight each other all day. They would butt each other and stick each other with their horns. What they wanted most of all was to be picked to fight in the bullfights in Madrid. They were very, very, very strong and fierce and pick them. Ferdinand knew that they wouldn't pick him, and he didn't care. So he went out to his favorite cork tree to sit down. He didn't look where he was sitting, and instead of sitting on the nice cool grass in the shade, he sat on a bumblebee. Well, if you were a bumblebee and a bull sat on you, what would you do? Wow, did it hurt! Ferdinand jumped up with a snort, and he ran around puffing and snorting, butting and pawing the ground as if he were mad. He was the largest and fiercest bull of all, just the one for the bullfights in Madrid. bulb, and you know who that was, don't you? Ferdinand went into the middle of the bull ring. And everyone thought he was going to fight fiercely and butt and snort and stick his horns around. But not Ferdinand. When he saw all the flowers and the lovely lady's hair, he just sat down and smelled. He wouldn't fight no matter what they did. He just sat and smelled. And the Benderi arrows were angry. And the picadors were angrier. And the matador was so angry because he couldn't show off, he cried. So they had to take Ferdinand home.
Richard. I have a poetry written by me, and allow me to read it in Amharic. That's a part of art, so, but I have English translated, so Peter will pass it to you guys. ሀገሬን ባሰብ ቁጥር እንዲህ ያደርገኛል ካልጋው ከመሬቱ ያገላብጠኛል ጡት እንደተነፈቀ ሕፃን ያንሰቀስቀኛል በሰው ተከብቤ ሰው ይናፍቀኛል ከወዲያ ባሻገር እንነትን ትቼ እዚህ ይገኛለሁ በናፍቆት እህታ ውስጤን እያቃጠሉ ቀኑን በትዝታ ሌቱን በሰቀቀን ይመሻል ይነጋል የማያውቁት ሀገር ሀገሬን ባሰብ ቁጥር እንዲህ ያደርገኛል ፀሐይ ወታ እስክጠልቅ ሀገሬን ጊዜ እያልኩ ያከነክነኛል የማየ ፈገግታ የጎረቤት ሳቅ ጨዋታ የአብሮነት ኑሮ የአብሮነት ገጽታ ማንነት ምንነት ትርጉም የሚያገኝበት እግዜር ይማርሽ ሲሉ የሚፈወሱበት ቅንነት ደግነት ተካፍሎ መብላት የተለመደበት ካለ ፈጣሪ ብሎ የሚለግስበት የብቻምም ፈጽሞ የሌለበት አዎ እዚያ ሲያምክ ሁሉም አብሮክ ያለቅሳል እንኳን ሰርግ ቀብርህም ይደምቃል ሀገሬን ባሰብኩ ቁጥር እንዲህ ያደርገኛል ካልጋው ከመሬቱ ያገላብጠኛል ጡት እንደተነፈገ ሕፃን ያንሰቀስቀኛል በሰው ተከብቤ ሰው ይናፍቀኛል ሀገሬን ሀገሬን መንደሩ ናፍቆኛል ቴንክ ዩ
Thank you. Hello. My name is Ben Weaver. I'm going to start by reading a piece that I wrote about home from the context of the dirt and the water and thinking a little bit about how there's all kinds of stories around us all of the time. And as humans, I think we're thinking too much about what stories we want to create instead of what stories are trying to, what stories we could hear, what stories are coming through. Two birds flew out from a cloud. I looked up as they went overhead, making a triangle down to my heart. I've been thinking about how hope is a form of poverty because it steals the present moment. It creates debt by nurturing dissatisfaction, promising something or someone or some time other than here now with ourselves. As the birds faded, the point at my heart went sharp, stretching into a slingshot. And when they decided to let go, my eyes turned into the bottoms of stones and I awoke in the center of a glacier. History depends on forms of repetition repeating themselves, but the present moment offers endless opportunity to reorganize that repetition. This is what the wind does with seeds, the fox with their tracks. Eventually, the glacier began to melt and a story emerged. Collectively, we overthrew the cultural hierarchy that had embedded our lives in the destructive patterns and beliefs that insisted on putting our addiction for convenience and comfort over the needs of rivers and butterflies, that viewed Mississippi and walleye as resources rather than relatives, that asserted the word of adults was superior to the voices of children. Soon I was engulfed in cold singing water, pools of it in the hollows of my shoulder, all that remained of the glacier. I could smell an ending, like a storm collecting on the horizon. But from here, it didn't go how you'd think it might go. Endings are a linear construct, and this story is a spiral. Two runaway horses came up out of the river, and my breath filled with giant wings. I could blow holes in the rain, and the rain could also come inside of me. It washed out the poverty and sorrow that had accumulated from so much hope. I was not the only one that this happened to. It was happening to all of us. We built fires in the shadow spaces where forests had been. One by one, we were called back. We planted trees into the uncertainty and loss, transforming it into new systems of regeneration. Our wills became feral and regrew tails. As we unbound ourselves from hope, we reorganized the old rutted seams that had been worn by a residual fear for the unknown. The two birds flew back towards the cloud. The tension of the slingshot relaxed. The point of my heart was still sharp. This is as far into the spiral as I'm able to take you. The rest is yet to be written. I'll leave you with this reminder. The stories support the systems, and in turn, the systems support the stories. Be aware which system and which story you support. It is a trick of capitalism to rebrand because its extractive nature is happy to appear as a different form of energy, enabling itself to remain in control, to manage the pace and direction of change, ensuring that nothing actually changes. This is as prevalent a concern here today in this space as it will be at every other moment ahead. If in doubt, return to your breath. It serves as a constant reminder of reciprocity. If we give too much, we die. If we take too much, we die. Endings are a linear construct, and this story is a spiral.
Invisible, walking around the world. Those talking, but no one listening. Guns and brains are holding us down, where no one can see our slow, slow death happening so fast. The invisible walking around the world, born breathing like the wind. We exist, touch, and gone unseen, invisible. We have survived daily, and that has turned into centuries. and the Indians will be here until there is no more life here. We were the first here. God gave us this world for our home, but we're the invisible walking around the world, born breathing like the wind. But come on, come here to the Indians' home. For 500 years, it has been the refugee for refugees from the whole world. Why stop now? Don't let hate stop the dreams. Come make a home, all you immigrants immigrating. Come make a life here. There's enough for all of us. Come and be yourself any way you like, any way you want. There should be no walls around our homeland. This land was given to us by God for all of us to make a home. So come and share. This land is a home for all of us. Come on. But the Indians' homeland, we are exiles in our own world. We can never return home, even though home already. We will never return to the way before. Torn away, shook apart, will always be broken and shattered parts, forever passed on to the next generations, forever to live this exile life in one's homeland, where we are all apart. Come home, my Dakota Oyate, my Dakota people, so we can heal in living in this exile homeland. Called Migratory.
You will live in a homeless land with no life.
just a migratory lot. Ordinary is not the choir, and permanent is a luxury that the normal seek for themselves. God, wait, can I have a spot that is mine? God, just a small space with a tree and needs some water. Can I become one of them? A rock or a pebble or maybe even a mountain? God, wait, all is yours. Bears too. All that moves, all is migratory. God, am I in my place? Am I just a rock that water flows over, that the sun shines on, that the earth covers up, that the flowers grow up from, just like
up. I'll just say a short little bit about it. So for me, home is connecting with the earth. And I think that it's a kind of a critical time for us to all find a way to connect with our land and the planet. And I went out to the Badlands and I had what I call my camping cello with me. And it's the cello that I'll play next to a fire. and I went out there to this kind of remote spot and immediately was struck by the landscape and the spirit of the place and started playing my cello. And that's where that last piece that we just played came from. It was just, I was inspired when I came home and wrote that piece. And then I decided I needed to go back to the Badlands and see if I could somehow capture the sound and the essence of what I had experienced there. And so I got a grant to go back there and bring a videographer and an audio engineer. And the result is this video. We were there for 2 days and recorded. I just was playing improv, cello, solo stuff in the landscape and just responding to the landscape. And so I chose 4 pieces, quote pieces, from that 2-day experience and culled it into this 14-minute video that I think does a pretty good job of capturing the experience out there. It's very intimate, but also it's extremely, expansive. And so that's what you're going to see. And I'm hoping that the video is syncing with the audio. We were having trouble with that before. So if you see my arm going, doing something like this, and I'm actually playing a slow note, that's the reason. So. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Alicia McQuerrey. I've been in the SPCO for 18 years now. And I'm really happy, I'm an East Sider, so I'm really, really happy to play here. So my idea of home is a little bit different in that it changes from week to week. I've had a lot of fun finding composers of color lately. So this is a piece by Adolphus Hailstork called Flute Set. And I think I'm just going to play the third and fourth movements for you.
Thank you. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for being here tonight. Eastside Freedom Library, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be among such magical people. I'm a writer. My name is Kao Kalia Yang. And on the theme of home, I've been thinking a lot about wounds. I don't know if you all know, but in America, it's indigenous women and women of color who suffer from more miscarriages and infant loss than any other population. As somebody who's gone through a late-term miscarriage, the idea of wounds, these original homes, have been on my mind lately, particularly because in the last year, my good friend and the writer Shannon Gibney and myself have put together a collection of writings by and for Native women and women of color on miscarriage and infant loss, because it does not yet exist. After we went through our own experiences of loss, we shifted through the shelves very carefully, and we found that there was nothing for women like us who would experience what we've gone through. And of course, when I thought of my own experiences, I found myself thinking about my mother. My mother has 7 living children, and she has 7 dead babies, as she would say. And so I'm going to read, this is only my second time ever reading from this since I wrote it. So this is, but it will be out in a collection titled What God Is Honored Here in the Fall from the University of Minnesota Press. This is my mother, and it is called Either Side. My experiences of motherhood began gently. For all that I lived in worlds full of fear and death, for this I am thankful to have received the sweet blessings of life. What happened after is like a flood. I was heavy with my girls on my arms, their hands layered over my heart. I could not have prepared for what would happen. For the first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, and the sixth child that I lost, or as the Americans call it, miscarried. In Hmong, we call it tua minyua, to spill children. It does not matter what language we're expressing in. It is the language of loss. The language of almost but never, the language of forever and ever. The 6 miscarriages that happened in Thailand happened all in a row. They happened at a time when I did not have much food, when my body was so thin the wind blew me into a curve of bones, a hollow bow around my belly, always burgeoning with life, unable to hold it safely inside. Each of the babies came out sometime in the middle of the journey. They were dead upon their arrival, all were formed enough so that we could tell they were baby boys. All of them were thin and wet, slippery like fish. They came in waves of pain that reminded me I was alive, each in turn, reminding me of the price I had to pay to be alive. How do I describe the experience now, nearly 30 years after the fact? I was young and I was hopeful. I was poor and I had 2 living girls to care for. I was with a man who loved me enough, but was also learning how to love himself and live a life where he would never be everything he was afraid to aspire toward. We were Hmong refugees living on borrowed land, given food 3 days a week, expected to wait out the years, a day at a time for a possibility of a life somewhere we'd never been. Already divorced from the time when I had been a girl, I had become a woman full of the traumas of war and the happenings in the confines of the camp. I was a woman without options, a woman who had made a decision long ago to choose life, no matter what, and who had to live in the travesty of that truth. I was a woman who gave up on herself sometime in the space of those losses, a woman who tried to kill herself, even with her beautiful daughters and her husband by her side, because she could not look upon a life where she was the source of so much death. I had gone into a fight with B the night before. We were fighting so much to stay together, to stay in love, to stay alive in those years so full of nothing. My girls were sound asleep, sound in their father's love. The fight must have been stupid because I don't remember it now. But then all I felt was the eruption in my heart. I woke up early the next morning in a gray dawn. It had rained in the night and the earth was wet. The door to our sleeping quarters that we had cracked open after our fight to air out our love carried the flower blooms from faraway places to my nose. In the gray, I saw my husband, his arms stretched across the bodies of our sleeping children, a cover against the night, the cold, and the camp. In the early morning, I put my cold feet on the damp earth and I slipped them into my flip-flops. Outside, most of the camp was still asleep. The early morning roosters crowed their morning calls. Hungry dogs lurked in the shadows between the houses. I knew only the early morning merchants were up and on their way to the camp market. I knew that at the market they sold packets of pills that fizzed in the water. The pills are used to fizz up water to clean silver, silver that I didn't own. Silver like the traditional Hmong necklace that my mother had given me when I married B, a prized possession that I lost in the Mekong River on the night of our crossing, because I held tighter to my child and the token of my life as someone's. As I walked to the water jar near the landing of the shared patio to brush my teeth and comb my hair, I was quiet and dreamy. My steps were unsteady on the stairs. They felt weak. I had just had a miscarriage the week before, which one I no longer know. All I recall is that I felt pale and bloodless and cold. The cold was something I carried in my heart. At the water jar, I brushed my teeth with the cold water. I washed my face with a wet towel, and I combed my long black hair with a plastic comb. I secured the thick strands in a bun at the back of my head with a hair clip. Then I stood very still. I waited for a few minutes for some other family member to get up to hear people. Perhaps B call out my name, or one of my daughters murmur for me in their sleep. But that morning there was nothing but the quiet of a world that would continue with or without me. I could see the grave mounds of Hmong people on the faraway hills, the men and the women and the children who had died naturally, died from disease, or died because they had killed themselves. Bare places among the green grass. It felt to me that they were the only ones at home in this temporary place, the ones who weren't leaving, the ones who didn't defy the governments of the world who told us that we were refugees, and that we belonged to no nation, that we were people floating far away for the hopes of a home. I smiled at the defiance of the dead. I smiled at my own rebellion in response to the life that I had been living. I was at peace with the task that I set for myself because I believed this is what the world wanted of me. I thought about the babies I lost, each in turn a sliver of a life, the size of a cob of corn, the length of a banana, the width of a cup of tea. I thought about how each had died inside of me. My womb had become a casket. I thought about how each had been buried somewhere, free from ceremony or ritual, from the greetings and the goodbyes we granted those who have lived, who have been loved. I understood there was no room in my poverty for that kind of goodbye. I felt that I could not survive another goodbye. I took careful steps on the slippery earth toward the road that led to the market. My flip-flops were attracted to the earth like a magnet. Raising first one foot and the next was hard, but I persisted. I thought most about my mother on that walk to the market to the stall of the old woman who sold the silver cleaning pills I had seen many times before. My mother, who I remembered then as an old woman, only because I was too young to understand the process of age. My mother who had loved me. My mother who had loved me gently and well, who had given me on my wedding day the best of everything she owned, who told me not to forget her, who had said, her voice shaking, "When you have your own children, you will understand how much I love you, how much I will miss you." It was the thoughts of my mother that made the tears in my heart surface on my face. I was sorry I could not return to her alive and well, my children with me, laughing and loving. I knew that I was about to commit the biggest crime against her. How many times had she offered herself on the altar of death so that I might live? After my father died, she had looked upon my brothers and sisters and me and told us not to be afraid, promised us that she would protect us. After the Americans left and the communist Pathet Lao soldiers enter our village looking to deliver death, it was she who had said, "Kill me before you kill my children." And now I would be killing myself. The thought of her disappointment, her anger, her loss drew the water from my eyes and I unleashed my tears in a fine fall from my eyes. A cool wind blew when I stood before the old woman at the stall. From the veil of water in my eyes, I saw that she smiled at me in greeting. Her mouth soft and pink, her gums were bare. She asked, what can I get you today, young woman?" I had never been a good liar. I turned my gaze toward the little packets of pill laid out on her table. I knew the truth was in my eyes and the wash of tears on my face, but I didn't know which tiny plastic bag contained the pills I was looking for, so I looked lost. I said, "I'm looking for silver cleaning pills." She answered, "I don't have any." had not expected her response, I raised my gaze. I said, please help me. Her smile disappeared and she said, I will not sell you any silver cleaning pills today. I blinked the blurry from my eyes. I asked, what other vendors carry the pills? She said, I don't know. It is a long line from here to the end. You walk and you ask them, this old lady does not have any for you today. I had somehow thought that death would be easy, for all of my life had been hard, and it was death that I had been running from the whole time. Now that I was ready for the encounter, this old woman was not going to help me. She was going to make it hard for me. I said, I don't know what you mean. I could see her clearly now. The white strands in the hair fell from her bun. I could see her brown face, deep crevices of folded flesh, those steady, clear eyes looking upon me with concern. My hands, which had been cold, gripped the corners of the rickety table before me, a table filled with tiny packages of painkillers, herbal packages, box remedies, soap, toothbrushes, toothpaste, shampoos, conditioner, everything a person may need in the course of a life. I leaned toward the woman, she leaned toward me. Her old woman's hand fell atop of mine. They were warm and dry. Our heads were close when she said, I don't know whose daughter you are, or whose wife, or whose mother, but you will not be buying silver pills from me on this day. The tears that had just dried began suddenly again, earnestly now. The rain that had drizzled on the walk became a storm of liquid I could not contain. My throat clamped, my hands fisted in a last effort at the control. In the hold of her hands, her brown fingers tightened over mine, her voice gentled. I will not let anyone else sell you silver cleaning pills today either. I pulled my hands free. I said, you can't do that. I wiped my tears and I turned from an offer that was not lost on me. She didn't look like my mother, but she reminded me of her. Years after, I can still hear her call after me as I made my way away from her table. Mintai. I was not her daughter, I could never be. I walked, tears falling free, from one vendor to the next, asking for silver cleaning pills, feeling her gaze on my back the whole time. I defied her the way I used to defy my mother. By the time I reached the end of the line of vendors, I had only 3 capsules in my hands. None of the women would sell me any. A lone man had sold me 3. He said they were his last 3. Beside a grove of sugar cane in a corner of the camp, I sat by myself on a flat rock. I did not want to be found dirty and wet, just dead. I had nothing to drink the pills down with. I'd become too emotional. I wiped the tears from my eyes. I redid my bun at the back of my hair, cognizant that the early morning had left, and if I did not hurry, I would be found before the work could be done. I walked back to the market in a hurry. The slippery mud clung to my flip-flops. The romance of the morning was gone. I was suddenly exhausted. In my exhaustion, I fell. I lost one of the pills in my hands. When I got myself up, I could feel the wet of my sarong clinging to my legs. I had no more patience for me. I walked to the vendor with the drinks, my flip-flops, a mess of mud, and I bought a sweet drink, one of those syrupy drinks that my children liked, the kind that came from a plastic bag with a straw tucked at one end. On my way back to the sugarcane grove, I downed the drink and the 2 pills I had left. I sat on the rock, I raised my legs, I wrapped my arms around my knees, and I laid my tired head to rest. I'm going to skip to the very last chapter, the very last paragraph. My journey as a mother has been long, continues to be long. When you have son living on this side and son waiting on the other side, either place feels like it could be home. I know this is not what many people want to hear, but it is the way my life has turned out to be. It is my experience of loving across the divide of life and death. I ventured far to be here. I'll venture far to be there. I've tried to make that journey before, so I know nothing is easy. Nothing is close. Anywhere is everywhere when you're perpetually looking for a mother's love, looking to be a mother with endless love. Thank you so much.
Hello. Hello everyone, my name is Yoon Kim. I'm the principal clarinet of the SPCO. I'm not the writer, I don't speak very well, so I'll be very brief and short. I'll be playing two pieces, and the first piece I will be playing is called Arirang from Korean traditional folk song. It's about 3/600th variation of 60 version, and I've thought about so many things that I should say, and I totally blacked out. The song is about a bachelor and a maiden, their sorrow and fondiness, about they can't meet each other because of the deep river is between them, and I think it reminds me of my country right now, of South Korea and North Korea, which is divided by the situation, and they can't cross each other. And whenever they meet each other, for example, during Olympics or when we had the presidential, this song was always tuned and everywhere. And this is considered as unofficial anthem, and which was happened during the Japanese occupation of Korea in 1910 to 1945. It was considered as a resistance anthem to willingness of liberty and plight of labor, etc. And the second piece that I'll be playing is Astor Piazzolla, Argentinian composer's Tango Etude. I'm not Argentinian, I wish I could explain it better to relate it as home, but clarinet is considered as classical instrument and also jazz instrument, and Piazzolla has invented this genre tango by collaborating classical music and jazz, so it'll be very short. Hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Hello, good evening. My name is Mankwe Ndosi. I'm going to try to sing this without amplification, but we'll see. And thank you to the SPCO and the Ethiopian.
Become a nation undone. And so we remain a nation underlying, a nation underlying. When in the water it has to forget, punished when a mouth are not shut. I am African on Dakota land, family with the Anishinaabe, with the Hmong and the Mexica, the Amhara and the Arawak, the Korean and the Puerto Rican. I am of the global majority who recognize the earth as our home, place of love and struggle, place of elevation and injury, place of longing and isolation, a place of transformation. From the protection of small realms, we make for ourselves boundaries and borders, lines that air and water can only reveal, as lies the tensions between beliefs, illusions of separation, and false supremacies of horizon and history. it out. Recognize us. How long will our home recognize us? How long will our home choice to remain, no choice to stay, choice to leave, no other choice, choice, each day, here, now, choice, what choice will we make, what choice will we make?
I need amplification. Thank you everyone. Thank you to the artists. Thank you for everyone who came out to share the stories. There's food back there. I can't take it all home. So please, it's from 52 Market, right? Yeah, and it's stuff that they only do for special things like this. So, go be special.